Mr. Jos Heijmans, Valentin Akayesu en Saar Sirzat, yes, please. Just to introduce everyone, I think Tinika has already introduced himself, so if you are right, I already moved to Sahar Sirzat. Thank you very much for coming at such short notice. One element that that Tinika didn't yet mention is the current deal that has been that has been made, or if you can make it, if you can say it's a deal, I don't know. Anyway, it was more like an put upon Afghanistan by the EU, which was a choice to the Afghani government to either accept to take back refugees or to get no money anymore. Can you tell a little bit about that? What's currently going on?
Well, before doing that, I would like to start with a really short story because I thought we were allowed to introduce ourselves.
Yes, please go ahead.
I'm sorry. The story is about a girl. Her name is Niloufar. On this winter day in January, my father called me because he was asking me if I knew any instances in Breda, because there was an Afghan family who was going to be without shelter very soon. And on that day, I was actually very cold myself in college and telling my student colleagues what a bad winter day it was. And then I realized that I came here in the Netherlands in 1998, where the policy was very different. And me and Niloufar have everything in common. We're both 27 years old. We're both from Afghanistan. We're both young, ambitious women. There's only one difference, that is the policy. She came in now and I came 20 years ago, but the situation in Afghanistan is still exactly the same. That's what I wanted to mention, that tonight I am her embodiment, but I did have the privileges of the Western society. So if you look at me tonight in the panel, I hope you see her and the Afghans who didn't have the opportunity to be here tonight. So I just wanted to mention that. I myself, about the deal you mentioned, you had a question about that?
Well, yeah. By the way, you are a student and you're also connected to a campaign called Don't Send Afghans Back, because that's actually what's going on. Maybe you can tell a little bit about that. Brief.
Yes, because your question threw me off a little bit. I thought we were going to do an introduction. Don't Send Afghans Back, that is an organization. Well, it's not really an organization. They're activists who are around Europe who are making themselves, they are standing up for the Afghans that are not supposed to be sent back right now. And my dad is very active in it, and I'm near to those activities as well because of him. And it's because of the situation right now, due to the international laws, as Tinika mentioned, Afghanistan is considered safe. But Afghanistan is not safe, obviously. If you see the news, it's the runner-up unsafe country next to Syria. And that's the situation right now, and the Afghans are very struck by it. It's crucifying.
Okay. We'll talk about it later. I guess what we're talking about today is the challenges that we are currently facing, and I'd like to ask Mrs. Strick, how do you see the you have shortly talked about it, but what I do not understand, I see the European Union moving ahead with its policies, moving its borders increasingly into Africa and funding a lot of other governments to keep people out. And similarly, at the same moment, you see this right-wing populism and also even center parties calling for a change in the international conventions. Like, how are these two dimensions related? Are politicians feeding fear, or are they taking the fear and therefore making these policies? How do you see that?
Yeah, it's always difficult to disentangle those two developments. I think indeed it's a kind of vicious circle, but strengthening each other, actually. I have sometimes the idea that, especially right-wing populism, but this is a very broad definition. I mean, many parties are also influenced by the right-wing populism, that it works like that they have a benefit of creating problems, that there's a societal problem for which they have a solution. And so I have the feeling sometimes that they enlarge certain fears of anxiety, if the fear for the unknown or whatever, by emphasizing the numbers and the possible effects that it would have on social policies or the benefits of all of us, for which they want to get support from the citizens, so that because they, if they are in charge, they are going to change that and make them feel safe again. So, but on the other hand, it works the other way around as well. Then mm-hmm. also, if you create fear, it will affect in the end everything, of course. Mm-hmm. Well, I think we really miss more political leadership, people who just explain the context of the whole refugee mm-hmm. situation in the world mm-hmm. and explain our place in that, and that we have to also take our share. And mm-hmm. It's very difficult for, apparently, for leaders to do that.
Yeah, Sahar?
Yeah, and also, if you would put it very bluntly, it's money, and it's mm-hmm. always money. Because the European Union is a union and not a federation. We should never forget that. There are states very dependent of their own economic situation, and they just don't want to provide money because there are so many sanctions that the European Union has financially. But on the humanitarian level, they're not touching the political situations in the states. There are so many different countries within European Union that have their different policies, and so it's the battle of... it's a political battle in every different country wherein they give certain sovereignties, but they don't want to have, they don't want to give their political sovereignty to the European mm-hmm. Union. Mm-hmm. It's very much economical. They only want to benefit from it. Mm-hmm. And also with the Afghan deal, there are 80,000 Afghans that are supposed to be sent back per year. And in the Netherlands already, there is 1,100 Afghans already being sent back. There's a gentleman over there that I met who's here for 7 years now in the Netherlands and still doesn't have a passport. These are all crucifying deals on the basis of capitalism and money. That's just what I wanted to add.
Okay. So where we can sort of move as a last part of this panel, and I also invite you to jump in at this moment as an audience, because what you touched upon, Mr. Heijmans, is like the public support is very necessary. You're engaged with your people, and what's at stake here? We can do, like, there's nothing really going on, and there is like always conflicts about these issues, but nobody expected Brexit to happen. And nobody expected someone like Donald Trump to be elected in the US. So the things were utterly sort of unimaginable, but still they happened. And I think that's why I personally and many people around me are also worried, because this game of politicians playing or on fears, etc., it may just very realistically end up in the Geneva Convention being cancelled or changed in some way that it has no power anymore. So I think that's at stake. And you say, Mr. Strick, that we are in a vicious circle, between what the population so-called demands and what the politicians are pushing, there's money involved, you say, Sahar. And in the meantime, Valentin, you said we are even sponsoring like the biggest human rights violators in the process. So this is a sort of a very, I feel, a very negative circle we're in. So maybe we can, like, can we look ahead? What's the future? We the possible future is that it's very negative. But let's focus on what's possible and what we can do. Maybe Valentin, is that something as a first person? Would you like to react on that? How would you move beyond this vicious circle?
I think the truth should be spoken on this problem. I'm African, and I came from Africa. And yeah, I analyze the situation and I see many things. If EU want to cope, to collaborate with Africa, they should first accept that Africa should be strong economically and politically. Every time our politicians, I mean African politicians, talk about investment, foreign investment. But when you look at the reality, when this investment comes to Africa, how African people benefit from it? Foreign investors, Western investors, come with conditions and benefit. They don't pay, in most cases, tax, and they compete with local business or economic operators. So in that case, it's not, and even they use people, they hire people with very low wage. So to shift the life of people in this climate we have today of international business reality in Africa is not helping. The shift is not real. We are not benefiting. So we are talking about migration, but when it comes on trade policy, business policies, they keep quiet. They are not talking about it. Mm. So if Africa is not strong economically, life of people change, we will keep seeing this problem of people dreaming to seek, to look for life in other spaces.
Yeah.
And the other point I want to highlight on, this populism, the politics of populism, is pointing fingers on other.
I think we are about to close this off, but I want each of the panelists to say a final thing. But is there someone in the audience who maybe, apart from a supportive shouting, is there also a question to one of the panelists? Yes, you in the back.
Good evening. My name is Yusuf Al-Fashir. It's good that to see the mayor of Evert here. I was in Evert in 2014, in Azetse of Evert. That's great to see someone who was a mayor, and I don't know even he's him. It is a great, I think it is a good that you work for the community of Evert to be a cohesion with the refugees in Azetse, and I'm proud of that, what you have said, and I hope people of Evert will support you for a long, and you will be in a parliament of European Union to change a little bit. Yeah. My question is for Tinika Strik. I want to know that is there any kind of project or any kind of resolution that's going on in European Union to change some laws for the better world for the future? Thank you. That's my question only.
Okay. Maybe if there's another question, then we can take them all together. Is there another question in the audience? Yes. Here in the front. I will take it.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. It's sort of a follow-up. So I'm Ukrainian. I was lucky enough to come to the Netherlands to study and end up working here. But until very recently, it has been actually quite an humiliating procedure to get a tourist visa to come to European Union, because you need to submit everything from your financial status to your marital status to get a visa, you know, to walk around Paris or Amsterdam. So the idea of refugees receiving a right of safe passage through European Union in the European embassies back in the country sounds fantastic. I mean, it would resolve the crisis. But how realistic is it? How far we are from that? And what is the main obstacle for that to happen?
Thank you. One more question maybe, and then we turn to the, yes, or two questions. Then we turn to the, as a final answering session to the panel. Yes, you and you, yeah.
Yeah, hi, my name is Sophie.
originally from Rwanda, but I'm going to ask something to the mayor of Weert, Mr. Jos. It was really interesting to see those pictures you showed us. And what caught my eye is the fact that you started with a nice picture about the lady that got housed. That didn't get a lot of media attention. But then when we were talking about criminals, you were in the Telegraaf and you were at Jinning. What we've also been talking about is the fact that we see this populists trying to bring the negative alive. But how can we go away from that? So attending an actual talk show, for example, just because they're talking about the negative, while we're not seeing the positive that Weert is also doing in getting people together to assist a lady like that, because I think you're doing more of the good things with the good people and giving them assistance in integrating in the Dutch society instead of running behind criminals, even though they are there. So how can we go from participating in actually the negative? Because it's nice that we can go and be in the public eye and speak about what is happening in our gemeente. But how can we try to reverse it and say, okay, this is the positive, this is what you should actually see, and okay. So you can become more understanding.
Thank you very much. One last question.
Thank you. My name is Stasha. I'm a cultural anthropologist. That's not so important, though. I want to ask two questions. One, we should not forget the people which do not even have a refugee status yet, which are undocumented. They are a very vulnerable group, also in the Netherlands and also in other countries. And I think that, I mean, those people also should really get more attention, because they are, do not even have the right to stay in an AZC shelter, to get fed, to go to a doctor, to have anything. Yeah. And sometimes they are staying here for years. There's a local example. There's a group of people, 6 years already, they are straying through Amsterdam from squat house to squat house to squat house to squat house, living from donations. And secondly, obviously policies have to do with money, and also with the thing which I think Mevrouw Strik was talking about, that organization give a responsibility, just all the time pointing fingers to another one. As you EU countries, this also happens within the Dutch refugee policies, because when there's, for example, a forced deportation happening to, for example, Afghanistan, the KLM, who is deporting the person, will point fingers at Dienstterugkeer en Vertrek. Dienstterugkeer en Vertrek will point the fingers at the IND. Okay. The IND say no, it was the court. And
so but who's taking responsibility?
Yes, but the meanwhile, the procedures in the IND, that one person who is, for example, coming from Syria, everybody knows that in Syria is not safe and there's war. Why should this person be interviewed for 5 times to 5 different people? It's a very expensive procedure. And then after that, they are not even allowed to work. And that feeds again the populist opinion of people are lazy, people are taking uitkering, people are just coming for profit. Okay. And yeah, it's not really a question, but it's kind of a remark to think about.
Thank you very much. Yeah, there's a lot more than we can. There's a lot more than we can discuss tonight, and this is all part of the same dynamic, I think, which we was described. Very briefly, to each of you, like either give an answer on what has been asked to you, or very briefly, like, how do we move a step from this cycle that we're in?
Yeah. Very briefly, try to answer two questions. One is what's coming up, what's forthcoming in the European Parliament for a new legislation? Well, actually, the whole common European asylum system is now being renegotiated in order to get more common standards on reception and the procedures. But there are some quite negative aspects. The Dublin regulation, for instance, they did not manage to really come up with a new fair distribution system. And as they can't sanction, apparently, the member states, now it will be the asylum seekers that will be punished. At the moment that they will travel further, they will lose their reception, they will lose their rights in order to push them back to the first member state. So I'm very concerned about this new legislation. The other thing is the safe third country concept, which means that they are negotiating now that you can send someone back to a third country, even if not all standards are there in place of the Refugee Convention and so on. So this is also really, you see that this regulation is becoming more an instrument to make more cooperation with partner countries possible without having the human safeguards.
So. Little to hope from the legislation so far.
Yeah, but okay. I do agree very much that we really need to reconsider our foreign policy. We really have to find ways to have a fair distribution between all the countries and a really equal partnership with all countries.
Thank you. Sahar, maybe you can focus on what can we do currently for as far as it has an effect for Afghans? How can we move beyond what's going on?
To keep that answer briefly is almost impossible because there are so many issues involved, as you mentioned. What is in center of that is actually stability of Afghanistan, the same with Africa. It hasn't been stable for so many years now, and it's been abused, used and abused again and again and again. And ever since the UK military has gone away from that, the Taliban are back now. I even know a young man who became 18 and had to go back, and the Taliban has him now, and we still don't know where he is. So the non-revolvement principle is also not used. As you mentioned, undocumented people don't even have the right of non-revolvement, which means that you can go to the court and say, my life is in danger and I can't go back or else I will die. But if you are an undocumented person, you don't even have that right. So for me, the issue is you as a person, as an individual, have the inherent right to exist. You have the inherent right to have economical benefits or any benefits. And if you are stamped with these definitions, you're an economical refugee, you're a political refugee, we are all human beings. And that's why I started also with my first mentioning of Niloufar, who was undocumented, didn't even have a house. She doesn't have those inherent rights anymore. And that's what we are supposed to be looking at right now as well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Last word for you, Valentin.
Briefly, I want to, it's a call to everybody. It's time we raise together and protect the international law because it's about our life. I was recently reading and even yesterday night, you know, the US has already withdrawn from Human Rights Council. In Belgium, I was hearing that the Minister of Immigration was criticizing the system of the ruling, the precedent made by the European Human Rights Court. So those are the instruments that protect the people's rights. In France and Italy, there are voting laws criminalizing NGOs dealing with refugees. So I think it's time, it's a call to all of us to raise and fight for our future life. Our life should not rely only on what politicians say, what we do as a people.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone, with your all very original point of view.
Thank you.
One of the